Yes.
Okay, thank you. So today, this is the third presentation of this session, and actually, Mr. Tobias Winter and Mr. Kunker, we are already introduced the AGDI photovoltaic systems in this session. And for the last 2 or 3 years, we together trying to make this system popular in different platform. And I think both these other three speakers will agree with me that we did a lot of presentations together in a single dais for the last so many presentations. So this is actually, we know everything of our presentations, as I can say. That's why I was clear to give answer to the bifacial system and the irradiation level received on the solar PV system. Anyway, today I will talk about this agrivoltaic system, whatever we have developed at our institutes. And the project was started in 2016, and the project was installed in 2017. And then on we are working on the system, and it is a very nice to work in this system because everything is integrated in the system. And we can say that in our institute, we are working together in a team. In my institute, scientists from 32 disciplines are working together. So this is an example that how this integrated system works in a farming production system. We have scientists from renewable energy background. We have scientists from agriculture background also. We have scientists from plant physiology background, and we have scientists from livestock background also. So every scientist trying to give some ideas or give some new innovative suggestions to integrate with this system, because this has a large scope for every subject and every sphere there is a scope. Anyway, I will go to the system hypothesis first. Why this agrivoltaic system is required? Why the solar PV system or solar PV functionaries, which is conventionally working, is different from this system? I am missing my screen.
We still see the first slide, I think.
But I am seeing the screen of Max. How it has happened, I do not know. I am stopping my sharing and again sharing my presentation. Okay. So is it visible now?
Yes sir, it's visible sir.
So agrivoltaic system, why this term has been coined? Because we know agriculture is going side by side and photovoltaic generation is a totally different system. But what is the need for integration of these two systems together in agrivoltaic system? Because we are working in a dryland agriculture system or the rain-fed agriculture system, where there are so many risks due to climate change. For example, sometimes if the rainfall event is not occurred, then there is a risk in the agricultural production system. So farmers of this region are quite fed up due to this risk factor in the agricultural production system. On the other hand, the solar radiation availability is plenty in this region. In every island, it is the situation. So there is a large scope of photovoltaic based electricity generation using the available solar energy. But the photosynthesis process, which converts the solar energy through agriculture into food, actually it is an efficiency of 3 to 4%. Everybody knows it, that photosynthesis efficiency is 3 to 4%. But on the same land, if you install the photovoltaic modules, the efficiency of the photovoltaic process is 12 to 15%. So our main common resource is sun, and from this sun we can harness food and we can harness energy. A efficiency is 3 to 4%, and another efficiency is 12 to 15%. Obviously, the farmers will prefer the photovoltaic process to use their land, But if this trend continues, then agriculture will be totally hampered in this region, because there are so many risk factors associated with the agriculture production system. But to meet the future food and energy requirement, we have to integrate these two things together. That's why this agrivoltaic concept is coming, and it is more relevant in the dry lands of this world, wherever production potential due to climate change, due to weather condition, is a challenging task. So in those situations, again, water is coming as a crucial role, because in tropical countries, cleaning of PV module is a requisite phenomena, or it should be done to get an optimum generation for the PV plant. But in a dry region, where to get the water to clean the PV panel? There are a lot of conflicts between the groundwater department and the solar PV functionaries, and sometimes the groundwater department denies to give water or allocate water to the solar PV plant functionaries just for cleaning the PV module. There are so many other purposes for which water is to be supplied. For example, drinking purpose is the first priority of this region. Then domestic need, then agriculture purpose, then only your cleaning priority will come. So the PV plant functionaries are in a difficult position to how to clean this panel. So if we harvest water from the solar PV panel, then use and recycle it in the cleaning of this PV operation, then it will be a self-sustaining PV generation system in the dry lands. So these are the main concepts by which agrivoltaic system has been developed in Kajri, Jodhpur, 5 or 6 years back. And before installation of this system, we actually analyzed the solar resources available in the country and also available in Jodhpur, Western Rajasthan. For example, this is the solar atlas prepared by National Institute of Solar Energy. And from this map, we can see the red colored portion, the irradiation availability is around greater than 5.6 kilowatt hour per meter square per day. So this is the region where solar energy is available in plenty, Rajasthan, Gujarat, and whole this part, western part, southwestern part, you can say. And also in Leh and Ladakh, these portions, where this availability of the solar radiation is plenty. Okay. And if you see the monthly variation during the summer months, obviously this we are living in the northern hemisphere. So during summer months, the irradiation availability is much higher. Whether in winter months, irradiation availability is somewhat low. But one can say that whether we can get the maximum production or maximum generation during summer months, it is not so simple, because the solar PV efficiency also depends on the temperature of the PV panel. And I personally monitored the temperature profile of the solar PV module during the summer months, and you cannot believe we recorded temperature about 56 to 60 degree centigrade of the solar PV module during the hot summer months in the arid region. So at those high temperature, the efficiency of the solar panel is obviously reduced. So again, high temperature, high solar radiation is not always beneficial to generate the optimum amount of solar energy. So here comes, can we make some agricultural growth below the panel or surrounding the panel? Can we modify the microclimate so that the panel temperature will be reduced to some extent, maybe from 56 degree centigrade to 40 degree centigrade or 45 degree centigrade? So this is another hypothesis, that growing of crops surrounding the PV modules, whether it can modify the microclimate. And if modification of microclimate has been done, then obviously the PV generation, it will silently affect the PV generation. So this is the main concept. And this concept was actually started in Germany. And Goetze termed this concept most probably in 1982. And later on, Dupraj and followed by Maru, they have developed this agrivoltaic concept in France. Then also in Germany, these are the in Hegelbach, this is the solar agri PV plant. But all these plants are in a high structure, as already shown by my previous presentation by Mr. Tobias Winter and also by Mr. Tunker, that this all these PV modules installation in the agro PV system in European condition, it is in a high mounting structure. And in this high mounting structure, they actually, the thinking was that in the high mounting structure, the cleaning operations of the dust deposited on the panel may be a big issue, but it is not so much a common phenomena in European condition. But it is so much a common phenomena in dry lands of the Indian condition. Here the wind erosion is a major land degradation process, and there are so many dust load during the hot summer months, and it creates a lot of dust coverings on the solar PV panels. So if we keep the mounting structure quite high, there is a large difficulty in cleaning of the PV module. As already shown by one of the slides by Mr. Winter, that one stand is being used to stand on that structure, then only cleaning operations can be done. And you can note down that during the summer months, at least once a week cleaning is very, very essential. So because of this drawback, we designed a different concepts of the agrivoltaic system, that it should be as close as ground, only 50 centimeter ground clearance I have given. Then we have actually designed the three agri-PV designs. One is the single row design, another is the double row design, and third one is the triple row design. So in the triple row design, since there are three rows of PV modules in the array, obviously the interspace areas will be higher because of the shade created by this PV module will be longer in distances. And this is the top view design of the PV installation. So it is the single row, it is the double row, it is the triple row. And in the double row, the top row of this array is with the 60% PV density, whereas in the triple row, the top row is with the 60% PV density. And this design has been made keeping in mind the requirement of photosynthetically active radiation, which is very, very essential component for agriculture production system to sustain. If we fully cover the solar PV modules with the solar PV modules, then the availability of the PAR will be less, and then it will obviously affect the agriculture production system. So there has to be some compromise made between the two systems to make this integration a successful system. Otherwise, if we keep we will get the maximum income from the solar PV generation, and if we fully cover the solar PV modules in the array, then it is not possible to get that amount of income from the agricultural production system. So that compromise has to be made between this solar PV and the agricultural part. And this is the layout design of my experimental field. So this is block one with the single row PV array design. This is the double row PV design, and this is the triple row. And you can see here, there are six rows of the single row PV module, whereas there are three rows of the double row PV module, and there are only two rows for the triple row PV module. And for all these three blocks, the PV capacity is same, 35 kilowatt. The peak kilowatt is 35 kilowatt. The block size is also same, 32 meter by 32 meter for each one. So then we can make a comparison that which design is best, and both in terms of agriculture and in terms of the PV generation. So that thing we calculated in the last of the experiment. So this is the field view of different crops we tested. And for selection of crops, we made some certain criteria. Since we have kept the design very close to the ground, just for easing in the cleaning operation, the crop height should not be much more higher. So we have screened the crops which are less than 50 centimeters in height during its peak production stage. Then the water requirement of this crop should also be very much low. It should not be the high water requiring crop, because we have to sustain this system in a dryland agriculture. And third one, that it should cover the surface condition as much as possible. So these are the three criteria we made, and we selected different crops, whichever is conventionally grown in the arid region of the country, and we got some interesting results. During the kharif season, which is generally the monsoon season cultivation, or during the July to October, we can say this kharif crops, growth and yield of Vigna radiata, that means mung bean, was not affected by the shade of the PV module, whereas rest two are affected. These two are cluster bean and the chickpea. In rabi crops, the plantago ohata and cuminum cymina are significantly affected, means isabgul and cumin. These are significantly affected by the shade of the PV module. And among the medicinal crops, which should be in the covered condition throughout the day, for example, Cassia angustifolia, the sonamuki, which is a very common medicinal crops and giving some cash value to the farmers, because all the kaimchur is prepared from this leaves of this plant, so it has a big industry in the surrounding region. So this is a very economical economic medicinal crop. And second is the aloe vera. This aloe vera crop is also very much popular in this region, and so many aloe vera based commercial industries are available, where leaves are taken from the farmer's field and they are processing it to produce different types of aloe vera cosmetic products. And also the PV panel below this PV panel, the spinach crop, then amaranthus, all these leafy vegetables which do not produce the grain or fruit, we are using for the below panel growth. Why it is chosen for below panel? Because the availability of the PAR below the PV module will be less, and for this crops, they do not need to relocate the photosynthesis from leaf to grain. And if this thing is happening, then automatically shade has a big role on this plant. So that's why the leafy vegetables will grow much more better in the below PV module situation rather than the interspace situation. And we have also recorded, as you can see here, the intermittent shade zone, then fully open zone and below PV zone. The intermittent shade zone, there is a lot of effect of the shade on the crop yield of the interspace crop. For example, there are 10 to 15% decrease in this intermittent shade zone. As already shown in different pictures by Mr. Tobias Winter, that shade has a great role on the interspace crop. Then another interesting features of our agrivoltaic plants is the collection of the rainwater from the top of the PV module. And I hope this is the first design we have made to collect the drop of rainwater. Actually, these innovations came after a lot of struggle to get water to clean the PV module. Even in my farm, there are no free available water to clean the PV module. First, we tried with a bucket of water and cleaning the PV module with the mopper. Then it was not successful because it is creating lot of scratches on the glasses of the PV module. So it will affect ultimately affect the efficiency of this PV module. Then we thought because simultaneously we are working on the hydrological behavior of the landscape features in the arid system, and we are very much in a difficult position to get runoff water from the land, because here the soil is sandy in nature, the infiltration of the rainwater to the soil is very high. So obviously after a rainfall event, there is very little runoff generation from the land is there. Then we thought that the solar PV module is totally impermeable surface. So whatever rainwater will drop on the solar PV module, we can collect every drop of water. So why not harvest this water? But the cost of installation of this water collection system will be much higher. But I know this the value of water in the ADDP system. If we harvest 1 lakh liter of water in a single year with an annual rainfall of 300 mm, then the price of that water is much more higher than the water extracted from the groundwater. Because we know the pumping system, and if we can calculate that 1,000 liter, if we want to draw water, it will cost around 100 rupees. So this cost of water And we calculated the harvested rainwater from the top of the PV module, it is very negligible. So we recommend that every solar PV functionaries in the region should have a water harvesting system, either for meeting the different water demand in this region, either maybe domestic purpose or for drinking purpose or for cleaning of the PV module. Any purpose you can use, but you have to harvest it in this region to make it a sustainable one. So these are some field photographs of the AGPV system, growing of different crops and different aspects of the design. This rainwater harvesting system, then total cover crops, and the importance of this cover crops. Because in the winter season, there is not so much problem of the dust erosion. But whenever the hot summer season is coming, specifically during April month to August and September month, the wind velocity is around 25 to 30 km per hour. And during those period, these loose sandy soils is generally blown away quickly. And this erosion actually creates a lot of dust load on the top of the PV module. So if we maintain a cover crop in interspace of this PV module, whether it is giving your some economical yield or not, forget about that. It at least controls the wind erosion. And if the wind erosion is controlled, then obviously the dust load on the PV panel will be reduced. Then the water requirement to clean the PV module will be reduced, and your manual labor cost will also be reduced. So it has a very big role to cover the surface of the interspace area of a conventional solar PV plant functionaries. And we give so many consultancy services to different solar PV functionaries to avoid the aeolian hazards of the arid region. And we took a big consultancy of the NTPC solar power plant of 512 megawatt capacity in the Bardla, in the Rajasthan solar park. So this is the biggest advantage of integration of all these systems together in a agrivoltaic system. So these are the another photographs which are already shown in the previous presentation also. These are some capacity building program of this AgriPV system. And these are some operations of even the tractors can operate for plowing operations and agricultural operations in the agrivoltaic system. And these are some common crops grown in the agrivoltaic system. Then based on this experiment for two or three years, what we have found, because we have tested the single row design, double row design, and triple row design. And we have collected the data from the crop yield also, and also from the PV generation. And as we kept the block size of all these three blocks is same, and the PV installation capacity is also same. So there is a lot of competition between these three modules or three designs. And we found that double row model is the best model, with first row with the full density and second row with the 60% PV density. So this is the design we made, and this is the recommended crops for interspace area: kharif season mung bean, rabi season isbagul, because it is a very good cash crop in the region. And below PV area, some leafy vegetables can be grown like spinach and amaranthus. Apart from these crops, we are also trying some more economic crops. For example, strawberry, whether we can grow, because it is a vine in nature and it can grow in the interspace area and also in the PV below PV module area. So this is our future endeavor, that whether much more cash crops we can grow. Then another interesting feature of this agrivoltaic system, most often we do not consider it, but I think it should be considered whenever agrivoltaic design has to be made in any location: the availability of the daily light integral at the interspace area on the ground surface. What is the daily light integral? And it is measured through photosynthetic photon flux density. Everybody knows that the radiation available on the ground surface, the 400 to 700 nanometer radiation is already only used for photosynthesis purpose. And there are two main regions, one is blue region, one is red region, where the photosynthesis 1 and photosynthesis 2 is occurring. If the light availability to the ground surface is less, then we cannot integrate the agriculture component in the solar PV plant. So in conventional solar plant, just for growing addition of agricultural activity, should not be a proper design for agrivoltaic design. But agrivoltaic design, you have to compromise your PV orientation or PV design in such a way that according to the crops grown in your agrivoltaic, the light requirement, there is a common list that for this crop, this is the daily light integral requirement. So if I want to grow a strawberry cultivation with the agrivoltaic system, I need to know what is the daily light integral requirement of strawberry plant. If I want to grow cucumber, I want to know what is the DLI requirement of cucumber. Then only I can optimize my PV orientation design so that agrivoltaic, the land equivalent ratio or the integration, synergism between these two systems will be at a maximum point. 80 plus 80 is 160, whatever Mr. Winter has showed. That thing only is achievable when we design this PV system in such a way that it should also match the agricultural part. Otherwise, our agricultural economic part or agricultural yield part will always be lower than the conventional one. So we did some modeling exercise and we found that in block 1, block 2, block 3, different DLI zones. For example, the red one, 0 to 5 mole per meter square per day. Then somewhat orange, 5 to 10, 10 to 15, 15 to 20. Okay. So if you can see, this is the zone where the DLI is very less. What is the value? Less than 5. In less than 5 mole per meter square per day, we cannot grow mung bean. We cannot grow different types of crops as shown in the previous slides, that it is not possible to grow crops with a DLI availability less than 5 mole per meter square day. And these common literatures are available that for this plant, we can need this much of DLI. So for this zone, DLI less than 5, we recommend to grow only vegetable crops with some leafy production system, not grain production system. For any crop which have a grain production system or fruit production system, they need much more DLI. For example, tomato. If I want to grow tomato, as the example shown by PM Chauhan sir from Gujarat, in their that PV system installation and tomato crop, the yield was quite higher. And I read the report because the DLI is actually matching with the PV design they have made. For tomato crop, the high DLI is not required. This medium range. So in this zone, we can easily grow tomato. And if we expose this tomato crop to a very high amount of light, then obviously the stress will be occurring, because so much radiation is available and so much evapotranspiration losses of water will be there. So plant will be at a stress to grow in arid condition. So we can cut up some amount of radiation to those tomato crop and we can bring it down to this 15 to 20 DLI requirement. Then it is sufficient. Then if we want to grow some very tolerant crop, drought tolerant crop, very hardy crop, we can grow in this region. So in the agrivoltaic design, from the solar PV below module to the interspace areas, we can divide this zone into three distinct zones. One is the totally shaded zone, one is the partially shaded zone, and one is the totally open zone. And in these three different zones, we can choose selectively different types of crops. We cannot grow the same crop from the solar below PV module to the interspace module itself. Okay, so then we come to the economic parts. Economics means how it is sustainable, and so many questions have been raised that whether this grid integration of the agrivoltaic system and how it should be make a business model for a large scale operation. For example, here you can see we choose 1 hectare land as the area, and here 400 kilowatt we recommend. Why 400 kilowatt? Because conventional solar power plant, 500 kilowatt is the optimum size. So we are compromising 100 kilowatt in 1 hectare area to give some space to the crop. So agrivoltaic system with agrivoltaic design with 400 kilowatt capacity in 1 hectare, it has a discounted payback period of 10.4 years. And internal rate of return is 16%. So if we reduce this 200 kilowatt, 400 kilowatt to lower down to 200 or 250, somewhat designs as shown in Japan also, the interspace between the two PV modules is quite high, then obviously the capital cost or cash outflow will be reduced and obviously this discounted payback period will be more or less same or sometimes higher, and it has an internal rate of return of 16%. So we can see that the agrivoltaic system has a great future to promote in the lands where the agricultural production potential is in some constant. I cannot recommend this agrivoltaic system to a land system where agriculture is the main operation or main activities, and the cropping intensity of those land is 300% or 200%. In those land, I cannot recommend the agrivoltaic system. But the land capability classification, if you know it, there are 8 classes are there in land capability classification. Class 1 to class 8. Class 1 is fully fit for agriculture purpose, and class 8 is only fit for grazing purpose, or it is totally barren. And class 4 is the middle one. So class 5th onwards, whatever land is available in India, that lands can be utilized for rehabilitation of degraded land, and also for PV generation, and also for the agricultural purpose. And this is our future target of the sustainable development goal in our climate change summit. We have already committed, and we are working on land degradation neutrality. We have to neutral 26 million hectares of degraded land by 2030. We have to neutralize this much amount of land, and where from we will rehabilitate or reclaim those degraded land. So agrivoltaic option is the most potential option, as already reported by Baron Gafford from USA, California. He also published a paper in Scientific Report, and he clearly mentioned that dry lands is the future through agrivoltaic model to achieve the land sustainable development goal number 15, the land degradation neutrality. So agrivoltaic system has different role in different system. Again, the carbon footprint reduction, we are talking about the clean energy generation. The carbon footprint reduction, we have calculated assuming that the emission factor of the thermal based power plant is 820 gram or 0.82 kilogram carbon dioxide equivalent per unit of electricity. So if we generate this agrivoltaic system with 1 hectare in 400 kilowatt capacity, we assume that 479 ton of carbon dioxide footprint is reduced from 1 hectare of land, and this is a huge carbon footprint we are reducing. We are here assuming that the PV has also some carbon dioxide footprint during its generation process, and also during its establishment process in the field. But during its generation stage, there is no carbon footprint. So this is very negligible, and we can assume that 479 ton of carbon dioxide equivalent carbon footprint we can reduce. And again, this is another answer to the question raised by Susmita madam in the first lecture, that what should be the model for upscaling of this agrivoltaic system. We do not want to see it has a 100 kilowatt pilot model. We want to see this as a megawatt model, and for this thing we are doing a lot of policy documents for the last 2 years, and this is the model we propose. And I specifically raise this slide in every presentation, that what should be the model, business model, to promote in a large scale. I made it in different forums, and the PM Kusum scheme actually in the component 1 target to install this system in to some extent with this large scale operation. Here I replicate the purchase power agreement document of the solar rooftop system as implemented by Government of India. We in our institutes installed a rooftop system of 375 kilowatt system with no investment on the solar PV part. We called a RESCO company, fourth partner. They installed, they invest, we only provided the roof. And the purchase power agreement has been signed between Kajri Jodhpur and the fourth partner. And we are in an agreement of 25 years. The agreement is that whatever electricity we will produce, that solar plant will produce, we will purchase it. If any extra amount of electricity is there, that electricity will be sold to grid nearby discount. So this agreement has been done, and we are running in a very successful model for the last 2 years. Every year we are saving 25 lakhs of rupees, just by paying rupees 3.19. This is the DISCO bid, 3.19 per kilowatt hour in Rajasthan. Even by paying or by getting a tariff of rupees 3.19, the DISCO company is also already in benefit. They have showed us in their LCC calculation that within 8 to 9 years, they will be in a profitable situation because they have made all this investment. So here, both Kajri and the fourth partner will be a win-win situation even after 9 to 10 years. Even Kajri Jodhpur is a win situation even from the first day itself. So whether similar model can be replicated in the agrivoltaic models, whether a agreement between the farmers and the DISCO company can be made to install a agrivoltaic system where land ownership will be given to the farmer and the solar PV ownership will be given to the DISCO company, and whatever responsibility for crop yield and farm produce will be given on the farmer, and the DISCO company will take part the PV generated capacity, and the total revenue generated will be shared between the farmer and the DISCO company as per the agreement. So this is a win-win situation, or the public-private partnership mode, whatever we are talking. This should be an ideal model to install it in a large scale, and this thing we have already done in the Dhule district. Mr. Tobias Winter was saying in his presentation that 7 megawatt agrivoltaic plant has been installed just 2 weeks back, and we are working with them for the last 2 years to convince them to install this system in a large scale. They visited our agrivoltaic system for quite a few times. We are already in their board of studies meeting for quite a long time, and they have made a partnership with Panasonic. Grow Solar with the Panasonic, they have made a partnership. Grow Solar will take part the agricultural part, the Panasonic will invest on the solar PV part, and they have made a common venture to install the agrivoltaic system. And I hope this will be the most successful venture of the agrivoltaic system in the country, and hopefully from 2022 onwards, our agricultural activity will be started on that plant. And some benefits of agrivoltaic system and some drawbacks, as we have already made during my presentation, that so many benefits of agrivoltaic systems are there. Increased income from farmland, recycling of harvested rainwater, improvement in microclimate, reduction in soil erosion by wind, reduction in dust load, improvement in land equivalent ratio. We have achieved 1.41. In France, they have achieved 1.62. That means 41% additional advantage over the conventional system, whether you are practicing solar PV, whether you are practicing agriculture. So there will be 41% increase. Then soil moisture conservation, then reduction in carbon footprint. And some drawbacks are also there. The ownership issue, this managerial complexity, then sharing of benefits in case of joint venture, then high capital investment during initial establishment. And this can be taken care by a suitable policy measures like PM Kusum. So we did some policy documentation also. The renewable energy, a new paradigm for growth in agriculture. And this is available in our academy, National Agriculture Science Academy. So in their website, it is available. And I am not going into details because I have taken too much time now. Already 25 minutes is over. So these are the some solar PV pumping system we worked for marginal farmers. And we gave some solutions to harvest the rainwater from the ground surface, make a farm pond, and use the solar water pumping for irrigation purpose and grow some commercial crops. So this is also we are working for two or three projects funded by international agency also and funded by NABARD also. In so many programs, we are trying to harvest rainwater, whether from land, whether from solar PV module, and we have to optimize the water utilization in the production system. So this is our main mandate of our organization. So we are working in different aspects of this irrigation and water use. And last month we published a paper. You can go through it. The performance evaluation of solar PV pumping system for providing irrigation through micro irrigation techniques using surface water resources in hot arid region. And this is published in Agriculture Water Management. So in this paper we described all the aspects of the solar water pumping for marginal farmers. I am not talking about the big solar pump of 3 HP or 5 HP. I am talking about only for 1 HP solar pump for a 1 acre model, how it can be sustainable for Indian condition. So thank you very much for giving me opportunity to share the findings of the agrivoltaic systems at Kajdi Jodhpur. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Santra. That was quite a very comprehensive presentation. You also spoke about the